Okay, welcome back, everyone. We're now joined by Ajay Arora, CEO of Vera Security, to talk to us all about the cybersecurity things that Donald Trump, president-elect, is going to have to think about and worry about as he gets ready to make this transition into the Oval Office. So thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
This is a guy that has talked a lot about the Secret Service that he's been working with recently. Even in his speech when he won the presidency, he wanted to thank the Secret Service for all that they've been helping with. You've seen the Secret Service follow him and his family all around. But when it comes to cybersecurity, you know, what are the things that he needs to know, be mindful of, and take very seriously going into office?
There's a lot, obviously. And, you know, just to kind of put in perspective, I hope he takes it more seriously than he does with his hotels, because if you remember about a year ago, his hotel chain was breached.
So
he puts a lot of emphasis on cybersecurity and saying how it's broken and we're vulnerable and all those different things. But there's a lot that it has to be taken into account. And I think a lot of the fear mongering that's been going on is not helping anybody, right? So serious issues, right? How do you deal with encryption? How do you deal with privacy? Mm-hmm. How do you deal with these increasing number of threats that are coming? It's not enough to just pay it lip service. You have to go ahead and actually do something about these different things. And so it's not just the attacks coming from external nation states. It's attacks that that are just the basis of like being able to secure your data, having it, the control over it, and making sure that everyone in the U.S. is protected from these kind of attacks.
Right. Now, you're based out in Silicon Valley.
Right.
Now, when you were out there this past weekend, over the Election Day period, what were you hearing from the people in that community? You saw Jeff Bezos come out kind of congratulating. You saw Apple CEO writing an internal email to his staff. What are people kind of, talking about in the industry right now?
I think it's just like it is here. I mean, people are in a state of shock. I mean, there was no secret that Trump wasn't loved very much in Silicon Valley for a variety of reasons, not just because of cybersecurity, but just a stance on a number of things. I mean, immigration, being able to bring talent into the U.S., and people are shell-shocked, just like they are here, and they're wondering what it's actually going
to
mean.
Do you think when Trump has to think about these issues for himself more, that maybe he will change his view? We don't really exactly know what his view now is, but will maybe alter his view on how he deals and works with some of these tech companies in terms of them and what they want to keep private for their consumers and whatnot.
That's right. He has to. I mean, when you're running for president and you're running for office, you can speak a lot of different rhetoric, right? But when it comes to brass tacks and actually having to deal with these issues, right? How do you handle going into people's private accounts? How do you handle going into their private email? These are issues you have to deal with, right? If you think of analogies in the real world, I mean, the way that Trump was speaking about cybersecurity during the election was almost saying, hey, there shouldn't be any kind of encryption. There should be no locked doors for your digital life. Imagine if the strategy for dealing with things like physical terrorism was saying, hey, I need a lock to everyone's apartment, in Manhattan, and I want to come and go as I please. That's very analogous to what he was saying before.
Would his administration have the ability to enforce that? So let's play back, rewind to February, the Apple versus FBI debate.
Yep.
Let's say that happened again in Trump's first 2 months of being president, something, God forbid, on our soil. Would he be able to force Apple to do that if we were to replay this again?
Well, so he was pretty clear in his position on Apple that he thought that they should have let it break break into the phone and get the information.
Right.
And he even called for a boycott on Apple devices, even though he didn't boycott it himself. But yeah, it's very true. They can place a lot of pressure on different companies to be able to violate some of their fundamentals,
uh-huh.
Right? And so there's companies like Apple and Google and Microsoft that can deal with it at that level and they have the resources to. But smaller companies like us.
You mean deal with it legally?
Well, deal with it legally or deal with it, in the shadows, as he likes to speak, right? The idea of that putting pressure in other ways, using the NSA, using other kind of FISA rights or whatever to be able to go in and be able to ask for this kind of information under cover, right? Under the cover shadows. So large corporations can fight that. A lot of the smaller ones can't necessarily do that.
Let me ask you this. We've been talking a lot down here as who are the winners and losers with the Trump presidency, and there have been clear gainers, drug stocks being one of them. I'm looking at them up on the big board right now, up other stocks, some of the tech stocks, Apple in particular, down, as we know that Trump has singled out some of them. What does this mean for cybersecurity companies and cybersecurity stocks?
It means quite a bit. It means quite a bit. So cybersecurity is based on two things. One is the trust of your customer, right? And also the trust that the technology actually works, right? So if you start building these back doors into systems, or if I'm a big company and I want to place all my data into the cloud, and I have to worry about the government coming in behind closed doors, going in and seeking that information, you're going to think twice. So if people cannot trust that their data is safe, whether it's through encryption or cybersecurity, it could have a pretty massive disturbing effect. Mm-hmm. Right? Underlying all of this is trust.
Right.
So it's a contract you make with your customer. Right.
What does your company do in this space specifically?
Oh, so our customer, we are a data security company. So you can imagine us as security that follows your data everywhere it goes. So think about it like almost like a revoke button that actually works in an email. So if email gets out, if files get out, if in the case of Edward Snowden, if the NSA data got out, imagine having a kill switch to pull all that data back. And that's what we do.
And you mentioned that as a small company, you would have a sort of difficult time going up against any of these policies. Can you just expand on that a little bit more?
Yeah. So what we do is a fundamental to what we do is some of the things that we do data obviously is encryption, and then we attach other protections to data, like what people can do to your data and how they can manipulate it and all these different things like that. So we do carry encryption keys. If the government came to us and said, look, I have all this data that's being protected or is being stored here, and I know that you have the keys, give us the keys to that data, right? That's a pretty big ask. And if the government's coming in with warrants and lawyers and things like that, smaller companies are not going to have the resources that an Apple, a Google, a Microsoft, or any of those companies do. And so that could cause a lot of strain.
Okay. Name your top three companies that you work for, your top three clients.
So one of the interesting things about working in cybersecurity, they don't necessarily want to publish who we work with.
Right.
So because that opens a data loss vector for them, a cyber hole for them as well.
Okay.
So we do deal with a lot of Fortune 10, Fortune 50 customers, uh-huh. Measuring in the dozens. So okay. It's a really new technology that a lot of companies are embracing.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks
again. Thanks for having me.
Okay, a very important conversation here. Well, that is it for today.